8 as well that they downgraded to 4.3. So that's two 4.8s that were downgraded to 4.3s. Anyway, same size quakes going all the way across. Let's go over back to the USGS map. Show you same size quakes went up out of Japan, over across into Alaska. This is the last 24 hours from the USGS. Here's the last 48. So you see it. Stepping stone path of the same size quakes that we've been talking about on all sides of the plate, going up and around and over into Vancouver Island. Guys, up in Canada, check it out. Let's zoom in and show you. Here's Vancouver Island, and the new earthquake struck right on the tip of the Juan de Fuca fracture zone, which is really just this jagged edge fracture zone. Those jagged edges actually belong to the Pacific plate, and they're stuck and locked in there. But this wave comes up, over, around, and goes back down into the Juan de Fuca fracture zone, then gets absorbed into the United States, goes around our craton, just like it went around Europe. I told you the wave went around Europe through Romania. Well, this goes down around through Texas and back up to the northeast. Look at the last 7 days worth of earthquakes. Check this out. If you're new here, you didn't know this. Fours and threes on the West Coast. Threes going down to Texas. Threes and twos going across the Midwest and up the East Coast. And it makes like a U shape that goes around the outside edge and back up the East Coast. Now look at our arrows. I didn't put these on there after the fact. These have been on here for 10 years. We don't move the arrows either. This is the way we expect it to flow. It's like a river. So the seismic did it again this week. Went down and around through Texas and back up the East Coast. What does that mean? It means there's something flowing down and around through Texas and up the East Coast. Earthquakes, right? But what's causing that? Something's causing the earthquakes to go down and around and up the East Coast. It's not just random. It happens every week this way. So why are they striking? Well, there's a standing wave that's going down and around the edge of the craton and back up the East Coast. Now that we know that there's something coming from somewhere and where it's going to, and we know the general direction by which it travels, we can then plot the course for it and do forecasting. So this is a fundamental principle that people maybe don't understand if they're a skeptic of earthquake forecasting or something. They didn't know that the earthquakes are going down and around following a trajectory every week. And if they follow a trajectory, which they do, and they're the same size going across a whole mass, then we can then determine that's a standing wave. And now that you understand standing waves, or maybe you heard the word enough, you'll go look into it. So we got the same size quakes, like a standing wave, going across and down into the United States. But in the United States itself, we have swarm activity taking place with no large earthquakes yet. We're about to go up. We got a 4.3 to 4.8. Again, they downgraded this, but whatever. Let's just call it a mid-range 4 to upper 4, striking here. It's going to flow down and into Yellowstone, down through Yellowstone into Colorado, down through Colorado into Texas, through Texas over to the east and up the East Coast. This wave, the seismic wave. As it comes in from the northwest, I'm expecting it to drop off a new 4.5 or similar-sized quake. That's why it matters what they report out here in the ocean, because that will tell us what size of a flood, a seismic flood, if you will, that's coming in. And if they misreport the size of the rainfall, you won't know the size of the flood, right? Until it develops. So it's pointing in like an arrow right down to Yellowstone. This is 48 hours worth of earthquakes traveling across the area, proving that there's a trajectory. Again, diagonal line, northwest to southeast. Look over the last 7 days, and all it does is fill in that arrow-like shape right down into Yellowstone. So I'm going to expect a new 4 to strike in Idaho, next to Yellowstone, Chalice Reserve. We're going to look for a new 4 to fill in right in the middle of all this. New 4 to 4.5, same size that struck out at Vancouver. We're also going to look for a new 4, maybe even bigger, maybe 4.5 as well, in Seattle, next to the Seattle Fault Olympic Peninsula. So it's two sets of fours, one on the backside, one on the front side. Or backside of what, right? Looks like an arrowhead. That's why I have arrows there. The reason we have arrows there to begin with, pointing in and down and across, is because we've seen this for many, many years travel across the area. Down to the south we go. We're going to look for a new 5 to 5.5 to strike at Eureka, coming in on the south side of the Juan de Fuca. On the north side, up here, I already told you about it. You got a 4.3 to 4.8. South side, we're going to look for something just a little bit bigger. Why? Well, fives are going around the rest of the planet. Let's just go back and show you one more time. Well, 4.8s to 5s are going around the rest of the whole planet. So we're not going to be immune on the coast of the United States as this wave intersects. And it already is up here, the wave 2 days ago, already vibrating in, letting us know something's coming in. So on the south side down here where it meets into Eureka, expect it there. Now, many people in Southern California, you're probably going to have to wait a few days for this to happen. 2.4s to the north, Seattle and Idaho. 1 near 5 or 5 striking at Eureka. Down south, let's go look up the earthquakes and just go see what's at each location. So where do we start, right? Well, let's go start with the rare earthquakes over on the east and southeast. A lot of people contacting me about the earthquakes that have struck. So we got a rare earthquake up in Wisconsin, right? There it is, 2.5. Mole Lake, Wisconsin. It's pretty rare. Let's just go take a look and see if there's anything there nearby. Again, viewers contacting me, I like to look this stuff up live so that there's, well, surprises that can happen if I look up things live, and sometimes surprises are good. Other times, surprises are bad. Now, I'm just wondering, what do we have nearby? What's this? What are those? Uh-oh. Some kind of retaining bonds of some kind. Usually where there's retaining bonds, there's usually some kind of other thing going on. But without any evidence of pumping, I really don't have anything to show you there with the retaining bonds. Wonder what else is going on up here. Looks like we've got a little bit of quarrying going on right next to the earthquake epicenter. Now, the earthquake striking down below, I would wonder, is there anything else here worth looking at? For instance, we would look for large power plants, power lines, and other features in the plate that might stand out as odd, like this. Okay, I've seen enough to know that there's something going on there geophysically. On one side, we've got a bunch of lakes and depression areas. On the other side, we've got a gash in the earth that goes on for 100 miles. And I'm going to start to think that maybe something's going on there and that the earthquake right next to it is related. The only other thing that we could possibly talk about is the strange series of retention ponds that have been built here that look an awful lot like something you might see at a fracking or oil or gas pumping operation. But I see that this flows in. I wonder. Okay. Could be a water treatment facility, too, but there sure are a lot of lakes around there for there to be a water treatment facility. So if you're wondering what's there, that's what's there. I told my viewers I would look it up. If we find anything, we'll show you. Now, over to the east, we're next to the nuke power plant. And I don't want to get too heavy into the nuke power plant stuff in this update. Just know that there's a nearby nuclear power plant, also methane drill points for gas. But I'm more interested in what's going on down here in Louisiana. Hall Summit, Louisiana, at a 5 kilometer depth. Let's go put these coordinates in and go see what's there. Inquiring minds want to know what's there. Let's go paste and search it. So we go from an area that's seemingly innocent. What's down here in Louisiana? Well, I don't know if this looks so innocent. Look at all these little things in the ground that are look like they're gravel pads of some kind. Well, they are gravel pads of some kind. And each gravel pad is containing a tank, a pump, a jack, and a pipeline. We've got a bunch of oil and gas going on down here. Mainly gas, mainly fracking, wastewater injection. They are doing oil too, so we got oil pumping going on right through all of these as well. We also have the salt domes to the south where they store a lot of gas. But every single one of these little square things here on the ground is a different oil or gas pumping operation. We just go down the road and you see how many there are. Then we back it out, you see how many there are. They're all over the place. Right? I mean, it's a lot. It just keeps going and going. There's more over here. I mean, it's not up for debate. You guys are welcome to come zoom in on any random location. I'm just randomly zooming in on these, and you will see the tanks, the pumps, the jacks, and the pipelines, mainly for gas. Now, it goes all the way across Louisiana. So all the way across here, back up to here, back up to here, back up to the quake. And then we stop with the drill points. And we pick back up here. So you see, we go from on the edge of a huge pumping operation that extends far north up to here. Look how many there are. I mean, for crying out loud, look how many drill points there are. So you start fracturing in the surface. Guess what? It only takes a little bit of fracturing in the surface of a giant piece of stone to create a crack through the whole stone. And then it takes force applied from below or the side to crack that stone once you perforate the very top of it. It's a fundamental principle that breaking stone apart, cleaving huge pieces of stone by just scoring the surface and then putting a few small metal pegs and breaking it with a little bit of pressure from the outside. Same thing applies to this, only over a massive area. And that's why we're breaking there. So we're breaking there to the south because we're next to a pumping operation. The wave is seeking out that rare point as opposed to, for instance, going into the New Madrid seismic zone and breaking at the natural bend in the plate on the New Madrid seismic zone. Let me show you the New Madrid seismic zone bend in the plate where it would normally naturally catch at right in here. It looks like a lowercase n. This is the Mississippi River Valley from erosion, but you can see the mountains go over, up, around, and come back down, then make a hard U-shaped bend through the south, and then go up the east coast. Those are mountains. This is river valley. But now you'll remember New Madrid seismic zone with that N-shaped bend in the plate, and normally we would go up into it and the standing wave would get caught there. But it sought out this spot here, the drill point down to the south. Okay, that caps off the earthquakes over to the east. Every single earthquake in Oklahoma is directly next to a drill point. So, do I need to take the time to show them all to you, or you guys want to go do that yourself by pulling the USGS coordinates and look them up yourself? Let's go put them in and just prove it. Again, proof, right? Take a look. So the seismic wave that spreads across plates spreads to drill points. And, whoa, what is this? Hold on, what is this? What are those? That's a huge coal-fired power plant. Electrical generation. Did I say there were drill points nearby? Where are they? There's got to be drill. Ah, here. There we go. More oil and gas drill points. 500 or more thousand drill points across Oklahoma. There's more that are closer here. Hold on. There's got to be more that are closer. It's a lake. Now I wonder how close they'll put it, right? Huh. Here's another set right there. Oh, wow. It's got the... I wonder if they're putting chemicals... They would put chemicals in here, I think. I'm pretty sure. Put the chemicals they want to put down into the ground there. Now, the question is are there any drill points here up on the north side? What's this place? Okay. Enough investigation. We've got ourselves a huge power plant and multiple drill points. Now, I mentioned the nuclear plant over at Ohio here and the earthquake there that I didn't look up. I looked it up in a previous video if you want to go. Again, 2.6. I'll just show you. Turn on our borders and labels. And the nuke plant right here. And the earthquakes over the past 2 weeks striking across this road over here. And then we have gas drill points along this road here for methane. So nuke plant, drill points, nuke power plant, drill points, earthquake. Now we get back over to the other location and it's the same thing. But it's a power plant, coal-fired power plant. So it's not the nuclear material that's causing the earthquake. It's the power that's being generated, very low frequency. 120 hertz, 60 hertz, and or 240, and or more or less, but we're still talking low frequency in the power station and the transmission lines that come off of it. So we get Mother Nature's very low frequency in the plate, and we get human-made up on the surface, and where the two collide as scalar forms. The scalar is just a complex term to describe an area where something intersects. Where the scalar forms, a new wave is generated, which is a standing wave. The waves don't pass through each other. They interact with each other. Oh, man.